स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज डॉक्टर स्मिता नायक, प्रोफेसर एंड एचओडी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फार्मास्यूटिक्स एट गैलोट इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ फार्मेसी कोपरखैरन। इन टुडेज लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू फोकस ऑन द बॉम्बे शॉप्स एंड एस्टैब्लिशमेंट्स एक्ट 1948, अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एक्ट एज फार एज द वेलफेयर ऑफ एम्प्लॉईज इज कंसर्न्ड। It deals with the facilities that the employer has to provide in his establishment to all his employees. For further reference and more details about this act, you can download the act from the net or you can refer to the textbook on forensic pharmacy by Dr. B.S. Kuchekar, Khadtare and Itkar. In this lecture today, I am going to provide you an overview which will make it easier for you to understand about this act. Moving forward, this act is meant to regulate the conditions of work and employment in shops, commercial establishments, residential hotels, restaurants, eating places, theaters, and other places of public amusement or entertainment, as well as covers other establishments, including pharmacy shops. The main objective of this act is to ensure a fair deal for employees of all the above. This act provides for hours of work, periods of rest and intervals, leaves, holidays, etc. of employees. This act begins with several definitions such as apprentice, child, closed, day, employee, employer, holiday, etc. I have picked up some main definitions from this act and listed here. These definitions are important from the view of understanding more about the employer-employee relationship as well as from the examination point of view. So the first definition which I have listed here, word to word from the act, is that of shop. Shop means any premise where goods are sold either by retail, wholesale, or where services are rendered to customers and includes an office, a storeroom, godown, warehouse, or workplace, whether in the same premise or otherwise, mainly used in connection with trade or business, but it does not include a factory. So factory is not included under the Bombay Shops and Establishments Act. Rather, it is included under the Factories Act, which we will see in the next chapter. A shop also does not include a commercial establishment, a residential hotel, restaurant, eating house, theater, or any other place of public amusement or entertainment. The second important definition from the point of view of the subject of pharmaceutical jurisprudence and you as a pharmacist is that of a commercial establishment. So a small scale establishment is a shop. And a larger one is called as a commercial establishment, and this includes any establishment which carries on business, trade or profession or any work in connection with or incidental or ancillary to any business, trade or profession, and it includes the establishment of any legal practitioner, any medical practitioner, architect, engineer, accountant, tax consultant or any other technical or professional consultant, and also includes a society registered under the Societies Registration Act 1866 and a charitable or other trust, whether registered or not, which carries on, whether for purposes of gain or not, any business, trade or profession or work in connection with or incidental or ancillary thereto, but does not include a factory, shop, residential hotel, restaurant, eating house, theater or other place of public amusement or entertainment. So an establishment which employs a large number of employees comes under the definition of a commercial establishment. So what are the steps involved in starting your own establishment? The very first step is to register the establishment. So how to register the establishment? The employer of every establishment who wishes to have his own setup shall, within 30 days of the act, send to the chief inspector of the local area concerned a statement in a prescribed form together with prescribed fees and the following details. So what are the details that are necessary? Let us just have a look at it. The name of the employer and the manager, if any. The postal address of the establishment. The name, if already available, of that establishment. And the category of the establishment. That is, whether it is a shop or whether it is a commercial establishment or it is a residential hotel or it's a restaurant or eating house, theater or any other place of public amusement and entertainment. Also, number of employees working, if available, will be shared with the inspector. On receipt of the statement and the fees, the inspector shall verify the correctness of the data given, and once he is satisfied about the correctness of the statement, he will register the establishment in the Register of Establishments and shall issue a registration certificate to the employer. Such a registration certificate received shall be prominently displayed at the establishment. The registration certificate so granted is valid up to the end of the year for which it has been granted. So this could be a period of 1 year, 2 year or 3 years. Whenever the certificate expires, application for renewal shall be made in the prescribed form at least 15 days before the expiry date of the current certificate, and the prescribed fees should accompany. An employer of an establishment shall notify to the inspector within 15 days if there is any change in the name or address of the establishment or in any of the particulars contained in the statement that has been submitted earlier. If the inspector is satisfied with the correctness or the changes that are necessary, then he will make the change in the register of the establishment and issue a fresh registration certificate or amend the current registration certificate. Similarly, the employer, if he wishes to close his establishment, shall notify the inspector within 10 days. The inspector will inspect the data and, on being satisfied about the correctness of the notice, remove the name of this establishment from the register of establishment and cancel the registration certificate. So right from registration of the establishment to closure of the establishment, the entire process has to go through the inspector appointed for this purpose, who will make note down the change in the register of establishments and issue the registration certificate, or he will cancel the name of the establishment from the register of establishments and cancel the registration certificate. So this is the process of registration and closure of the establishment. Now let us move forward to understand what are the provisions made under the Bombay Shops and Establishments Act. One of the important provisions under this act deals with the opening and closing hours for any establishment. So as you can see, there are six categories of establishments listed here in column one. Then the opening hours for these have been prescribed, and the latest closing hour, the last closing hours have also been prescribed. Before we move into and read this table, note, it is very important for you to note that pharmacies and chemist shops are exempted from the provision of opening and closing time. This is because they come under the category of essential health services. Okay. So moving back to the different types of establishments, shops dealing in perishables such as milk, vegetables, fruits, meat, bread, etc. Other shops, shops dealing with pan, bidi, cigarette and other ancillary articles. Commercial establishments such as financial banks, etc. Hotels, restaurants and eating places, and places of amusement and entertainment. For each category, you will find the opening hours not earlier than. So you have the milk booths opening up not earlier than 5 a.m. Commercial establishments 8:30 a.m. Theatres and other places of entertainment, it is not very well defined here. And you have the last working hours. So restaurants are supposed to close by 12 midnight. Places of entertainment and amusement by 12:30 a.m. Shops dealing in milk and vegetables and others can close by 8:30 p.m. Right? So thus, the Bombay Shops and Establishments Act tries to protect and benefit the employees and see that they are not overworked by defining the opening and closing hours as shown in this slide. Now, I'll give you 2 minutes to read about the different types of establishments here and their opening and closing hours for yourself. So once you read, the whole thing is self-explanatory. Once you read it, you will come to know exactly the provisions that are given to the employees so that the employer does not exploit them. Go through this slide by yourself. So if you have been through this slide, let us now move forward to the next provision, that is given under the Bombay Shops and Establishments Act. And this refers to the hours of work, the total number of hours of work that an employer can expect an employee to give. So here there are three categories now: shops and commercial establishments, hotels, restaurants and eating places, and theatres and other places of amusement. As you can see, the maximum number of hours that an employee is expected to put. The normal working hours are not more than 9 hours per day and 48 hours per week. Okay. However, any employer may be required or allowed to work in a shop or a commercial establishment for a period in excess of the limit fixed, but the period should not exceed 6 hours in any week and not more than 24 hours on any 6 days in a year. For festival or special occasions, the state government may fix by rules not more than 10 days in a year opening and closing for restaurants or eating houses. So there are exceptions to these general rules, especially during festivals and special occasions where the employees can work for more number of hours in a day. So for more details, you refer to the Bombay Shops and Establishments Act itself. Then coming to the interval for rest. Employer cannot expect the employee to keep on working continuously. He has to give rest to the employee. So what does the Act say about rest? The working period for an employee should be so fixed that no period of continuous work should exceed 5 hours and no employee should be allowed to work for more than 5 hours before he has an interval for rest of at least 1 hour, or such period may be reduced to half an hour for commercial establishments engaged in manufacturing or if so desired by the employees. So what this tells us is that continuous work for more than 5 hours is not permitted, which is why you have these short breaks. A total rest of 1 hour at a stretch or split up or lesser than that is necessarily to be given to the employee by the employer. Coming to this word spread over. What is spread over? Now you have a shop. Let us say you have a place of amusement which opens at 7 in the morning and goes on till night 11 or 12 p.m. or 12:30. No employee is expected to work for 12 to 14 hours in a day because the maximum hours he or she can spend is 9 hours. That means there has to be shifts, or there has to be an overlap of different employees. So one employee comes in the early morning and goes in the evening. The second employee comes in the afternoon and leaves at night. So this overlap is called as spread over. The spread over of an employee in a shop or a commercial establishment should not exceed 11 hours in a day. If any shop is on any day entirely closed for a period of 3 hours or more, then the spread over shall not exceed 12 hours in a day. So the spread over of an employee in a hotel, restaurant or eating house which has long working hours should not exceed 12 hours. Coming to holidays. Each shop or commercial establishment shall remain compulsorily closed 1 day of the week. The choice of the closing day will, however, remain with the owner of the shop. The employer shall prepare a calendar or list of such closed days at the beginning of the year and display prominently in the shop. The shop or commercial establishment may be allowed to remain open on a day notified as closing day if it gives any other day as a holiday. Okay. And also the government or local authority will fix the closing day for most of the shops and establishments. No deductions shall be made from the wages of any employee if on account of the day on which the shop is closed. So compulsorily one day of the week the shop has to be closed and the employer cannot deduct salary for that day. Let us see exactly what is the opinion of this act as far as employment of children, young person and women is concerned. It says, this act says that no child shall be required or allowed to work in any establishment. So children below the age of 14 are not allowed to work legally. No young person or women are allowed to work in any establishment before 6 a.m. and after 7 p.m. or 8:30 p.m. respectively. No young person shall be required or allowed to work for more than 6 hours in a day. So young person as young as 16 to 18 year olds, while they are permitted to work, cannot work for more than 6 hours in a day. No young person shall be required or allowed to work for more than 3 hours in a day unless he has had an interval for rest for at least half an hour. In case of adults, they can work continuously for a period that does not exceed 5 hours. In case of young persons, those who are 16 to 18 are not permitted to work for more than 3 continuous hours. And absolutely no young person or women are allowed to perform such work that is declared by the government to be dangerous, involving danger to life, health or morals. So a lot of terms and conditions and precautions have been laid down to safeguard the health, safety and welfare of young children, young persons and as well as women. Coming to the calls for leave with payment and payment of wages, here in this case it says that the persons employed in shops and commercial establishments shall get the following type of leave, that is privilege leave with full wages, PL, which is also called as PL, full wages, not less than 15 days after 12 months of continuous employment. So once the employee has worked for 12 months or more, he or she is entitled to privilege leave, 15 days or thereabouts, with full wages. And such a privilege leave can be accumulated up to 30 days. Sick leave or casual leave, not more than 12 days in a year with full wages. This leave cannot be accumulated. It can only be consumed when a person is sick. Every employer should fix a period on which the wages shall be payable to employees. And all wages must be paid in cash or check, whatever, and should be paid within 7 days of that particular day. The employer is entitled to make a deduction from the wages of the employees for reason of any fine or absence of duty or loss of damage of goods, loss or damage of goods, house if it is accommodation is provided by the company, advance tax or advance taken by the employee or overpayment of wages, deduction in the form of income tax and for the purpose of bank loan, cooperative society loans, etc. are can be officially deducted from the salary of the employee. Employers if they make deduction from the wages of the employee for the purpose of loss or damage, has to explain why this fine has been deducted, and he should give it in writing and also give the employee an opportunity to justify and explain why such a fine should not be deducted. The other important aspect that is covered under the Bombay Shops and Establishment Act is the provision to the employees with respect to the environment, cleanliness, ventilation, lighting, as well as safety. It says, the Act says that all establishments should be kept clean, well ventilated, and sufficiently lighted. The establishments should also be free from any effluents rising from the drains and any other nuisance. Arrangements have to be made by the establishment to provide drinking water to the employees. And all establishments should make suitable arrangements, and safety norms should be in place in case of accidental fire or any other risk. There should be provided and maintained a first aid box in every establishment where manufacturing process is being carried out. The Bombay Shops and Establishments Act expects every employer to furnish a letter of appointment to the employee, and this appointment letter should contain the name of the employer and the establishment, the postal address of the establishment, full name and age of the employee, hours of work, and date of work. Similarly, suitable conditions for termination of the services of an employee have been laid down in the Act. For the purpose of enforcement of this Act and to ensure that the provisions are being complied with, regular inspection of establishments is a must. For this purpose, the government may appoint a chief inspector and other inspectors to inspect the establishments that have been licensed under the Act and to satisfy whether the conditions of the license under the Act have been observed. Such inspectors are empowered under the Act to enter at all reasonable times any shop or establishment with a view to inspect the premises and examine all registers and records maintained under this Act. They can also exercise the powers that are entrusted to them under this Act. There are several offenses and penalties that are listed under this Act, and you can refer the textbook Kuchekar in order to understand about the offenses such as false entries in the register, omission of entries in the register, obstruction to inspectors in this register, or failure to keep records. All these are offenses and are punishable with penalties ranging from fine to imprisonment up to 3 months or more. Okay. So with this, we have completed the important Act, the Bombay Shops and Establishments Act, which first came into existence in 1948, but subsequently has been amended and merged with the Maharashtra Shops and Establishments Rules 1961, and it is being regularly updated with a view to taking care of the situation and the newer working conditions and terminologies that have come into existence over the last 50 to 70 years. So with this brief overview, I request all of you all to go through the entire Act, download it from the net and go through, or alternatively go through the textbook of Forensic Pharmacy by Kuchekar. Thank you and best of luck.